the work we're doing at Sage to explore how social scientists are engaging with the online environment. You may well know Sage is a very large social science publisher, very well known for that. But it's also rapidly developing our science program, particularly sort of our journal publishing. So we're very aware of a lot of the science network, the networks that STM, Academic Study and STM, are using, and some of the workflow tools that publishers are developing for those communities. So I want to talk today about two products that one we launched and the other is forthcoming, and some of the research we've done with those to understand how we can
provide value to our communities. So these are the three sections of my talk. The first, I just want to talk, both of the products that I'm going to talk about today are in the area of research methods, an area that Sage is particularly strong. So I just wanted to give a little introduction about that for those who aren't aware of that. Then wanted to talk about an online community that launched last year called Method Space. And then about a forthcoming product that will launch later this year, Sage Research Methods Online, and some of the research that we've done to explore that. So very quickly then, Sage is the number one publisher in research methods. I think I can say that quite confidently. Since Sage was started in 1965, research methods have been a priority in our publishing program for both our books and our journals publishing, and more recently our reference publishing too. We have over 1,000 book titles published in research methods across quantitative, qualitative, and mixed methods, as well as evaluation and research design, publishing some of the top authors, and we publish about 50 to 60 new titles every year. When I joined Sage about 2 years ago and started talking to our authors and some of our customers, I was really impressed by how much, when you say research methods, people say Sage, how strong our brand is in this area. So Method Space, this is our online community. About 2 or 3 years ago now, we launched a portal for research methods called methodology.co.uk. We weren't being very globally ambitious, I don't think, making it very clearly UK situated. The portal was designed to provide links out to materials of interest, websites of interest, feature Sage publications, and it was pretty static and we didn't get very much use on it. Then one day we decided to link a blog to it, and we invited one of our top authors, David Silverman, to write a blog post, which he wrote on Why Interview. And we saw a massive rise in the traffic to the site following that. And so that experience led us to start thinking about what more we could do to develop more of a community and engage more with our users. There was clearly interest in reading blogs and commenting on blogs from this sort of initial experience, so we wanted to explore that a bit further. Since then, methodology.co.uk has ceased and Method Space has emerged. Method Space uses the Ning platform, and when we first set it up, we weren't sure how successful it would be, how much are social scientists interested to engage in this topic in an open environment. With Method Space, you can create a profile with a nice picture, you can write a blog, you can create groups. So along the bottom here, you can see some of the groups that users have created, qualitative inquiry, postgraduate researchers. So you can network online, meet new people online in those groups, and you can create forums and participate in discussion forums. And we've been really surprised by how much this environment has been used by this community and how much people have wanted to engage. We've got reasonably limited Sage branding on there, but we're not trying to hide behind another wall in terms of our presence there. I want to show you some of the ways that it's been used. So Paul Graham is one of the users on this community. Hopefully he doesn't mind me showing his profile picture here. He uses the environment to post questions on forums, to share resources with other people that he meets and networks with on particular groups. He's got a group, this is it, called Knowledge Transfer Methodology. It's got 26 members. He's got a blog feeding into that group, and people are quite active in participating and communicating with him on those topics. We see quite a lot of people post questions, post research questions that other people respond to, and that's a large use for it. Vincent O'Brien uses it, posts a blog with some of his research and can upload videos in there and invite comments and critiques on his method, the visual method that he's using there. Nigel Gilbert, one of our big authors actually, uses MethodSpace as a classroom resource for classroom discussions, so he sets up group for his class. And he also spends a lot of time commenting, we've been surprised by this, but commenting on other people's blogs and forums to provide a sort of expert perspective. And of course at Sage, I'm sure Katie will be pleased with us putting this picture up of her. We've been using it to connect with our authors, to understand what are the hot topics that people are talking about, how can this influence our publishing programs, getting feedback and blogging at conferences. We've been really impressed by the level of activity we've got. We've got about, in the Q1 of this year, we had about 50,000 visits and over 150,000 page views. This gives you a bit of a sense of our sort of user profiles from individuals who register, largely lecturers, a pretty good number of students on there, some teachers, and then even a few librarians participating, medical practitioner there for some reason, wanting to participate on MethodSpace. I think there's a sort of industry guideline that if you've got about a 10% active membership, you've got a very popular community site network. We've got about 7%. So it's some indication that, you know, amongst this community, there is enthusiasm to engage in these sort of online networks. It doesn't just happen at physical conferences. And at Sage, we're certainly interested to pursue whether there are any other areas that we could do more work on here. So that was a bit of a, I'm doing a whirlwind tour through these, but that's a bit of an overview of MethodSpace and what we've been doing there. The next product that I want to talk about is Sage Research Methods Online, which we're due to launch later this year. About 2 years ago, the idea for this product emerged, and we were really thinking about developing an ebook platform, somewhere where we could put our methods books online, sell them into libraries, and that would be that. So we started doing some market research, and what I want to show you initially is some of the findings from that research. The graphs that I'm going to show you are from a survey that we did, and I'll tell you the response rates. We also carried out a large number of interviews. About 20 of our authors were very active during this market research phase and participating with us to develop the concept. And we had a number of focus groups with students. So we sent the survey out to 2,500 individuals who were our research methods authors and reviewers. So they were quite a targeted audience. And we had a 21% response rate, which we were astonished by. And I think it really made us believe that this was the right thing to do. We had 538 respondents to the survey. There was a mixture of the pie chart, so this isn't very prettily laid out, but the pie chart reflects whether the individual responding was primarily a quantitative, qualitative, or mixed method. Use those approaches, and then you can see the geographical spread. There's a bit of a skew towards UK there. You can see largely UK-US responses, and in the other territories it tailed off a little bit. So we asked how often individuals use online the online environment for research purposes, how much are social scientists using this, and, you know, pretty good response rate. Either daily or weekly was the sort of the hit areas for this question. With the interviews, we followed up on sort of why they were using it, and I think, you know, the really key time for researchers is at the beginning of their project when they're going online looking for literature and looking for case studies to use. After that, as they're pursuing their project and writing, they may use the online environment less, maybe just for reference purposes. What features do you most value in online products? I don't know if you can see this, so there's the chart is divided into sort of the blue is academic researcher responses, the mulberry is postgraduates, and the yellow is undergraduate responses. So the search facility is key, links through to other materials that are referenced in the text, keywords and related linking, and interestingly over here another big thing that was valued in online products was making it easy to print. So there's a sense that, you know, when you're online, your approach as a researcher is to browse and discover. It's to move across material very quickly, to see links from references, related links, searching, reviewing material, and then downloading or printing for in-depth reading at a later point. And that was something that really influenced this sort of sense of browse and discovery as online, really influenced the product development. How do you find new research methods materials? We've got things along the bottom, like library catalogue searches, publisher catalogue searches. This chart, I think, has been thrown up a number of times today, so this is my version of it. Internet searches, online searches, references within text, recommendations from colleagues, supervisors, browsing in bookstores, browsing in online stores, and direct publishing from publishers. And direct marketing from publishers. And I think what's striking from this is that people are looking for our research methods material and the research methods materials of other publishers through a wide number of means. So there's not one route to find this. People dip into many different areas to discover the content. And one of the things that struck us from the focus groups and the interviews as well was actually how difficult it can be to find research methods material. Many of the books aren't online, and often the journal articles that all obviously use a method for the research don't use the method as in their keywords as tagging. So even when you're searching through a range of journal articles looking for use of a particular method, it can be actually quite difficult to do that, perform that literature review and find that. We also asked what types of material you use. You know, is it true that we should develop an online book platform, or should we be looking at other materials in this? And I think this is what has led to the product containing not just books, but also reference material, journal articles as well. You can see across the for undergraduates here, the lemon-coloured bars in the chart, the reference material and introductory book material is stronger. But pretty much across all of these different types of texts are very useful. And one of the things that we heard as well is that from academic researchers is that there isn't enough introductory material on particular methods available. Another thing that came out as we were talking about this and the different types of materials that are used in a research project and when looking at selecting a method and applying a method is that there could be real value in starting with a sort of dictionary definition and then working out, starting with something very basic, working through then to book material and reading case studies and journal articles. One of the other things that we've done is to use Method Space to help develop this product. So we have this community on MethodSpace, and we have a development blog that's live at the moment on MethodSpace called Sage Research Methods Online, where I have a blog and I'm posting designs and inviting feedback. We have some forum discussions, and we have librarians on this blog as well as academics, which has been really interesting to see. And we're keen to sort of try and keep encouraging sort of that discussion going to support the development of the product and ensure that we're meeting those needs of the community. So I think what we've tried to do in this sort of area is to really identify, in the work that we've done over the past couple of years to develop these products, is to identify a niche where our brand has real value in our community, to develop a community around that, and then to deliver content to that community that fit into the user workflows and support that community further. And I think one of the really interesting things will be to see where we can go next with some of these products. What other content is useful for them, and how else can we support their research process? Thank you.
Questions for Martha?
Anthony Watkinson, UCL Cyber. I'm actually supposed to be here handling the microphone, but for some reason, no, you can if you like.
Joy.
But I have two questions, one of which is the easy one, probably. My understanding is you're making available in your searches, the searches that people using the system, the new product, the new service use, other people's packages or sources or products, yeah?
No, actually, it is for the
entirely
for
within
the
Sage
product. It will be Sage only.
Oh, I see. So unlike the OUP one.
Yeah, so it's very different from the OPP one. And actually, for the reason of, we've talked about that. So we talked about,
whether it would be possible
for people to add comments and add their own links to other resources, or whether we could index other resources and link out to them. And we got quite a bit of negative feedback from the library community about the idea of doing that without being able to guarantee the full text is resolved. So the feedback we had was that actually Sage being number one in this area means that people are happy for now just to get Sage in their results, so it will be just Sage content.
No, I'm not against it. I misunderstood you at one point. Ah. The second question I had was about the survey you did, and I thought it was your authors you were... The undergraduates cropped up somewhere in it, and I couldn't understand how that worked.
It's authors, I should have clarified, and that affects potentially the response rate as well. It's authors and reviewers, but we asked them to pass it on to students who could complete it as well, and there was an incentive for completing it. So we did have quite a lot of postgraduates. A much smaller number of undergraduates completed it, so... Probably the more interesting data to look at in that is the academic researcher and the postgraduate line.
Do you happen to remember the proportions? Because it's quite important. Only 2,000.
But I could send the...
No, I just... sorry, you know how it is. I'm just asking the undergraduates, if there were 20 of them, well, it's not very important, but, you know...
It was very low. It was more It was more like that. It was under 50.
Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Okay, thanks. I will carry this now.
Diane Cogan, I just wanted to ask about you said you developed a taxonomy, and presumably you've gone back and tagged everything?
Well, it's all been converted back
to the beginning, or how?
Yeah, we've taken PDFs and in some cases hard copies of the books and converted them all into XML. Okay. And then all of that is a combination of automated scanning through of the taxonomy and then a manual editor actually sort of confirming and refining the selected terms from the taxonomy for the tagging. It's been a big project.
Enormous. And going forward, presumably, you're incorporating that in as stuff's loaded online or something.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. There's also, I didn't mention, abstracts for books, they'll be automatically generated going back, but moving forward, all of our authors are now writing abstracts for every chapter in a book so that can be loaded in moving forward. But yeah, and someone mentioned previously the sort of permissions and the rights, I think the lady from Berg, and we've had all of that too, where we've been needing to go back, clear rights, pay for third-party permissions for electronic use, and yes, but there's been a massive back office sort of project that's gone on to make this happen.
I know that OUP had that problem with the rights issues, but that was some years ago.
Yeah.
There's lots of questions I'd like to ask, and I'll probably talk to you afterwards about some of these things, but how are you going to run Method Space alongside this new product? Do you have a sense about how they relate to one another?
What we'd like to ultimately see is quite a good deal of integration. So it would be nice if you had an account on MethodSpace to go into this Sage Research Methods Online, see your dashboard, get feeds from your communities, see content pulled up that's relevant for you based on what you talk about in forums, what your blog denotes. To begin with, those aren't fully integrated. There's just some basic linking that will go back and forth. So it's very much a project ongoing would be how we integrate that moving forward.
Just want to follow it up with the notion of community, because, of course, a lot of the methods teachers are trying to make a difference. That is to say, they're sort of the evangelicals in one sense, and therefore you're part of their armory. So it's quite interesting to see how you can find well-motivated individuals who want to hang out and talk to one another about, hey, how do you do logging analysis? How do you get these people to crack on what the ideas are, or whatever it happens to be?
Yeah.
I know at one stage Biosis had, obviously, and Zoological Record, they had interest at one stage of doing methods, it was difficult to see how that was going to succeed, and they were trying there. But obviously Sage has had that sort of an undergraduate position, but then sort of building on that to other sort of advanced levels, etc., going through. So in some sense, you're getting huge leverage out of your presence in that publishing area, then clinking into an area which I think will never go out of fashion in that sense.
Yeah.
My additional question might be, sometimes it's called information literacy. I'm not very comfortable with the phrase, but a lot's been talked about a surfeit of information, and the question then is critical appraisal, whether you have plans to think about how people use information sources out there, because actually you become part of the problem, part of the solution in that sense.
Yeah, and for the first step, it's very much about sort of what's inside this community, but certainly we're going to have a sort of a web resources section where we'd be linking out, which will be reasonably basic to begin with. But I think that it's a really interesting area to start extending. And some of the conversations you were having about data sets and making data available, one of the really big things that came out of the research was teachers would love to have sample data sets that they could use within classroom context to just share sort of things. Well, I mean, so that would be a natural next, something you could imagine happening, and we could link out pull data in and all of that when it's available. So I think, this is the beginning of something that could be really exciting in those areas.
Can I just say one thing, if nobody's going to speak? And this is terribly useful, potentially. And please be evangelistic, because I think Peter would agree with me, there is a huge need. I mean, I'm a layman in this area, but I'm part of a group which are full of, but the great majority of things which exist in, of surveys and so on, that exist in the information science community, never mind the publisher and librarian community, are absolutely rubbish. Okay? And if only you can evangelize this, and I'm in a situation where I'm teaching publishing students and library students, and we're having a research methods seminar in May, and they won't listen, of course, but there we are. Please work.
I'll try.
Okay, Anthony, I expect to see you signed up on Method Space next week. Good, thank you.